And I am not alone. Michael Martineau is at the news desk. How are you, sir?
Doing great.
Do you have anything you'd like to apologize to your meme for today?
I actually talked to my meme today.
You did talk to your meme?
Yeah.
Did she ask about me?
Yes, she did.
Oh, really? Are you saying that just to, you know, perk up my ego?
Or
if you are, you're not supposed to admit it.
Or she said she always loves when I'm on the radio, and she loves listening on KCOW.
Yes, KCOW, our new affiliate in Dallas-Fort Worth, KCOW, yes. See, so I was telling the truth about KCOW.
Yes, you were.
Your meme confirms it. Yes, it's all true. KCOW, the biggest talk and country music station in all of Texas. They have us on a loop. They carry the show live, and then they just play it over and over again, although they do include some a little bit of country music in between the airings of the show. A little bit of Vince Gill, I think. It is Vince Gill, right, Michael?
Sure, why not?
Yes, please ask your meme to confirm that next time you speak with her. Well, that's wonderful. And how is she?
She's doing great.
Good, good, yes. Well, I hope she keeps listening. Yep. Hello to Meme Martineau. Is that her actual name?
No.
Okay. Well, close enough.
Sure.
She'll know who I mean.
Yeah.
Clearly, yes, yes. Well, that's wonderful. That's wonderful, Michael. I have to reboot. This computer over here is rebooting. We're still going out live, but it was doing that weird thing where it was playing my intro music and it was like stuttering. I'll edit that out of the podcast because that's just annoying. But anyway, so welcome everybody. While that finishes rebooting, I'll give you all the numbers to call. You can call us live at 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Also, you can send a text. We have a text line for the show, 617-917-4476. You can tweet me anytime, at Matt Connerton, but if you tweet me during the show, I'll read your tweet during the show. And of course, you can email me, matt@ipmnation.com. So there is no shortage of ways to get in touch. And of course, we are proudly sponsored by the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street in the Brady Sullivan Plaza right across the street. You can see I've got my lovely Hop Knot mug here. The Hop Knot, of course, Manchester's premier establishment for delicious gourmet pretzels. They have craft beer. They have wine. They have board games. They have trivia night Wednesday nights. Let's see. They've got a $7 lunch special right now going from weekdays, 11:30 a.m. to 4 p.m., and then they've got happy hour from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. weekdays. Lots going on. And they've got the big ugly sweater party coming up on December 20th at the Hop Knot. And the website, if you want to check them out online, is thehopknot.com. And knot is K-N-O-T, as in pretzel knot, thehopknot.com. And it is a wonderful place. Have you been there, Michael?
I have not.
Oh, you're missing out. I would have thought a man about town as yourself would have been there by now.
Maybe in my future.
Yes, maybe in your future. Well, that's exciting. In an alternate universe, you've probably been there in the past, if you believe in that. Do you believe in do you believe in the multiverse theory? Like, do you believe that there could be an infinite number of Michael Martineaus or even an infinite number of your meme out in all these multiverses? All throughout space and time.
Yes.
There could be a version of you in another universe where you are president of the United States. And in that universe, you could be getting impeached. So that's my segue. You like that?
Yeah.
Actually, yeah. I'm actually still rebooting this computer, so I'm sort of stalling a little bit. But anyway, we'll say hello to everybody in the Facebook live chat. Jenny's in there. Jenny's the first one in today. Jim Bellot. Jim, I haven't seen you in forever. It's nice to see you in there. I never did learn where the how to pronounce your last name exactly. Is it Bellot? Is it Bellot? I'm not sure. I've always just known you as Jim. But please clarify. I want to make sure I'm putting the emphasis on the correct syllable. Jim says, with all this impeachment going on, you seriously think Donald Trump is going to be impeached? I don't think so. He will be our next president. Well, Jim, my prediction is, and I don't know how often you get a chance to listen to the show, but my prediction is and has been and continues to be, I mean, yes, the House clearly is going to vote to impeach him, the democratically controlled House. However, he will then be acquitted in the Senate. I know John Hopwood, you know, when John's on the show, we had a big argument about it one day. He kept telling me, oh, no, that the Republicans in the Senate will they'll convict him. You don't know history of this and that. But I think John Hopwood might be the only person I know who actually believes that Senate Republicans will vote to convict him. No, I mean, it's easy to see, you know, how this is going to turn out. He'll be impeached in the House. He'll be acquitted in the Senate, and that'll be it. And I do agree with you. You know, I mean, I don't like the guy, so I take no joy in saying this. But I do agree with you. He will win re-election. My argument being, well, what I predict will happen, this is what I believe, is that he will once again lose the popular vote, probably by a larger margin this time. But he'll still carry all the same states because he can lose the popular vote. But if he carries all the same states, he'll be able to win re-election. So, and I do believe he will carry all the same states because, you know, looking at the polling data and also too, just kind of gauging how people seem to feel about Trump, how Republicans feel about Trump. I mean, he's got, you know, typically between an 85 to 90% approval rating among Republicans. And, you know, so there really is, essentially he can do no wrong. As far as Republicans are concerned, he is your exalted hero. If you are a Republican and, you will, most Republicans I know are, I always say, let me put it this way. I don't know too many Republicans who simply like Donald Trump. Most Republicans I know are deeply in love with him, and they will stick by him through anything and will question nothing. The best example of this, and if you're a longtime listener, I'm sure you've heard me say this before, but the best example of this that I can come up with is the farmers. This trade war with China has decimated the agriculture sector in this country. Farming bankruptcies are at record highs, and farmers in the Midwest are getting killed by this trade war. It's been absolutely horrible for them. And yet, the polling data shows that the farmers, they'll blame anyone but daddy. They will not blame Trump. You know, they're like, I mean, and I've seen, you know, I've read articles and I've seen things on the news and online about, you know, when people go and talk to these farmers and basically say to them, you know, when journalists talk to these farmers and say, hey, just wondering, how do you feel about Trump and how do you feel about this presidency when his trade policy has sort of, you know, destroyed your livelihood and ruined your life because your family farm that had been in your family for generations is gone. And it's incredible. It's incredible. It's like the attitude of these folks is, well, it's pretty terrible what happened, but he's my president and I support him and I'll vote for him again. It's like, wow. So that's why I tell everybody, I say, no matter how you might feel about him, the reality is, I don't know. How do you beat someone who has that kind of a hold over people? I've never seen anything like it in the modern era. I mean, I can kind of think of other examples in history, but I've never, but I'm going to avoid making that because it's that comparison overtly because it's too easy and everyone does it. And I don't mean to be cliche, but in the modern era, I cannot think of another example. I mean, Ronald Reagan, revered by Republicans. Republicans used to love Reagan. Saint Reagan. Ronald Reagan would be envious of the love and adulation and unquestioning devotion of the MAGA folks. So because Donald Trump can ruin your life, destroy your livelihood, and you'll still support him, even if that happens. The farmers are proof of that. So he'll still win those states, even the states where the agriculture sector has been just wrecked by this trade war. He'll still be able to easily carry those states, you know. I mean, even if there's a dip in the polls in those states, he can just go there. You know, he can go to Iowa, you know, go to Nebraska, wherever, do a rally, say some bad things about immigrants, whatever. And his, you know, his poll numbers will be right back up among his supporters. So I don't know how you beat somebody like that. I mean, I just don't. Like, he literally can do no wrong in the eyes of most Republicans. So I just don't know. Like I said, I've never seen anything like it. To me, it's like the greatest example of mass hypnosis in my lifetime. It's incredible. It's incredible to me. So, you know, I mean, and you know, there are other examples. Like I said, I gave the example of Ronald Reagan. By the way, has anyone noticed that once Trump came along, everyone kind of forgot about Reagan? Like, everyone used to try to, particularly Republicans running for high office, Republicans running for president or whatever, they would try to invoke the name of Reagan in some way and even try to compare themselves to Reagan, you know, and say, they would say things like, you know, I'm going to carry the mantle of Ronald Reagan. Once Trump came along, Republicans just kind of, now Reagan is like this quaint memory, you know, and now it's all about Trump. It is 100%, the Republican Party is 100% the party of Trump now. I just don't know how you beat somebody like that. I really don't. The hold that he has over all of you who love and revere him. What do you think, Michael Martineau?
I do have my opinions, but it's,
you're in the right place to express them.
True.
if you want to.
I haven't really chose who I'm going to vote for yet.
Oh, all right. Well, might I suggest, I have a suggestion for you. I'm not trying to tell you to vote for it, but there's a certain gentleman who wears a boot on his head who I think is would be a fine statesman. If I may humbly suggest, Mr. Vermin Supreme.
Remember that time I went to that Andrew Yang event at Electric Avenue?
Yes.
Basically, he was there too, and I got $2 from Vermin Supreme.
$2? Cigarette butts?
No.
Oh,
bills.
Oh, $2. Well, very nice.
Yeah.
Well, you're supposed to donate to him, not the other way around. That's interesting. Wow. Well, that makes sense, though, because Andrew Yang is going to give you $1,000 if he's president. Hey, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, it's Jenny.
Hey, what's up?
Well, I was listening to you, and honestly, you're right in the sense that when I was a Republican, we always talked about the 12th Amendment of Reagan. You never speak ill of another Republican was the number one rule follow. You could have a disagreement behind closed doors, but don't bring it to the House floor.
That was
you have Trump, who will call a Republican a never Trumper. And not patriotic, and you know, leave all of those people behind, and basically push them out of the party.
That was
essentially I ended up out of the party.
That was Reagan's.
I know I'm not alone.
Reagan's 11th commandment: "Thou shalt not speak ill of another Republican." Yes,
right. But that was like drilled into my head.
Yeah,
it was really a big deal. It would be considered absolutely disgusting behavior to rip into another person on the floor, but if you wanted to have it out behind closed doors, that was fine.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's all, it's a whole new world. It's Trump's world now. It's Trump world. Very exciting.
Definitely not Reagan's Republicans, that's for sure.
No. I mean, you know, I'm not a great fan of Ronald Reagan, but he certainly comported himself with much more. Well, I think really any president comported himself with more dignity than the the current commander in chief, but you know, character doesn't matter.
You know,
I guess.
Absolutely. I mean, I gotta say, really, kudos to the guy, because I thought Clinton would take it out of the park with the blue dress, but nope. I'm figuring out how to top that one, even.
Oh, yes.
I'll let you get back to the show, guys.
All right, Jenny. Thank you for the call.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Let's see. We got a lot of. Actually, let me get to this first. We have a text message from a listener who says, "Hey, Matt, that was a great intro. I love that song. But what's wrong with making fun of other presidents? Seems like you only make fun of Trump. You need to be equal opportunity when it comes to making fun of presidents." So that was obviously a facetious comment, because this same person tweeted me yesterday when our friend Tony called in and gave me a hard time about I had played something yesterday. On the show. You were here, Michael,
yes,
for that.
Yes, I was.
I played something from the great Mrs. Betty Bowers. And if you're not familiar with Mrs. Betty Bowers, she's a comedian. She's a satirist. And she goes by the moniker America's Best Christian. And she posts these very funny YouTube videos. And so I played one of hers about the war on Christmas. And I played that because... not for any nefarious purpose, not because I think I'm going to guess that Tony thinks I'm some liberal secularist who hates Christianity and hates Jesus and all of that, which is not the case. I actually really dig Jesus. I like him. I like Jesus so much. I think it would be fascinating to actually treat other human beings in the same way that Jesus did in the Bible. But that's not really the cool thing to do these days. But I think it would be awesome, you know, to actually give a crap about other human beings. But I know a lot of folks who are really into Jesus aren't really into that part of Jesus. So anyway, and Tony accused me of, why are you making fun of Christianity, and why don't you make fun of Muslims, and why don't you make fun of Buddhists and Jews and everybody else? And I kept trying to tell him, and I don't think he was hearing me, but I kept trying to tell him, I'm not making fun of Christianity. I'm making fun of the concept of the war on Christmas, because we go through this thing every year, not nearly as much as we used to. I think peak war on Christmas was probably about a decade ago, when Bill O'Reilly had a much more influence. You know, he was on Fox and he was writing books about the war on Christmas. You know, the idea, and for anyone who isn't familiar, the basic precept of the war on Christmas is the idea that, you know, if someone says Happy Holidays instead of Merry Christmas, because maybe they want to be inclusive of everyone, or maybe don't want to offend someone who may not be a Christian, who may not celebrate Christmas. And of course, it's absurd on multiple levels. But the idea is that if someone actually says Happy Holidays instead of Merry Christmas, that person is a liberal, atheist, Christian hater, Jesus hater, who also probably hates America and thinks that we should all be communists and live under Sharia law, or whatever it is these people think about all the terrible things that you're supposed to believe about someone who says Happy Holidays, if you dare say Happy Holidays to another human being. So the war on Christmas, I think, is very, very silly. There is no war on Christmas. I think Christmas is very much intact. I did think it was funny that, you know, Tony chose to call and complain about this, by the way, on a day where later in the show I had Diane Ruggiero here, and we were featuring some of her new Christmas music with songs that have the word Christmas in the title. And yes, I actually played music. Can you imagine me, who sits here and mocks Christmas and Christians and Jesus and all that? I actually, in the same show, Michael Martineau, I might have multiple personality disorder. I don't know what could be going on with me, but me as this evil atheist, secular, liberal, Jesus-hating guy on the radio. I actually, in the same show, later on in the show, played music with the word Christmas in the title. What? Did I suffer a head injury at some point during the show? I don't know how I could possibly play something mocking the war on Christmas and then in the same show play Christmas music. It's amazing. But anyway, so yeah, so the whole concept of the war in Christmas, on Christmas is, in my opinion, no offense to those of you who do believe that there is a war on Christmas, but I personally think the entire concept is very silly, very stupid, and I think everyone needs to just chill out and not worry about it so much. I'm pretty sure my observation is, I think year after year, Christmas has survived. Everyone who celebrates Christmas, I think, I'm pretty sure, is allowed to continue to celebrate Christmas. I know a lot of folks who get wrapped up in this war on Christmas thing were very, very nervous during 8 years of the Obama administration, because I would often hear a lot of conservative Christians bemoan that they believed that at any given moment during the Obama administration, President Obama was going to sign an executive order declaring Sharia law and no more Christmas. And anyone who celebrated Christmas or said Merry Christmas would be summarily executed. That never actually came to pass. But of course, a lot of things these folks worried about under Obama never quite came to pass, you know, like, you know, Obama having the UN send in the black helicopters to confiscate everyone's guns. That never quite happened either. So there's a few things that Obama never quite was able to follow through on. But anyway, the point being, so I was making fun of the war on Christmas because I think it's silly and stupid, and I enjoy mocking the war on Christmas specifically. So we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
It's Easy G.
Oh, Easy G. By the way, Easy G, Merry Christmas to you, my friend. Merry Christmas.
Yeah, hey, yeah. Happy holidays.
Whoa.
What?
No.
Oh, my God.
Easy G. Easy G, I had to stop your theme music. Did you just say, I thought you were a good God-fearing man. You go to, like, multiple churches.
Nothing wrong with a happy holidays.
Happy holidays, Easy G. Have you suddenly turned to the dark side? What has happened here? Oh, my goodness.
I just said I'd get your goat.
Have you rejected? Get my goat. You got my goat, my cow, my my sheep. You got everything. You got the whole farm. It's like I've gone bankrupt because of the trade war. You got the whole farm. You're the bank. You came and took my farm away. I cannot believe this, Easy G. How can you turn your back on the Lord in this way by saying happy holidays? My goodness.
All right, Merry Christmas.
You voted for Hillary, didn't you? Did you vote for Hillary in 2016, Easy G?
I did not.
I'm starting to wonder.
For that third-party candidate there.
I'm starting to wonder. Are you pro-choice, Easy G? I do know. I do know, because you've acknowledged this, that you are fine with same-sex marriage. You think that's perfectly acceptable. So maybe I shouldn't be surprised that this happened, that you would dare say happy holidays. I don't know, Easy G. I'm worried for you. I'm worried for your soul. And so is Michael Martineau.
Yeah.
And so is Michael Martineau's meme.
Crazy things happened today. I was over walking by the, you know, that used to be that post office fruit. Now they sell kind of tasty bakery treats now.
Who does?
Well, anyways, it was these two cars earlier today around, I don't know, past 9 o'clock in the morning, and on the way to Market Basket, and they almost hit each other. And then the guy gets out of the car, which is the worst thing you can do about road rage.
Yeah.
And he starts swearing at the guy. He says, hey, what the hell are you doing? You know, blank, blank, blank. It's like, oh, my God, I thought you were going to have a fist fight.
Ooh, did he tell him happy holidays?
And then after that, I was over waiting for the free shuttle there.
Yeah.
And over by Citizens Bank, and this guy gets out of the car, and he starts taking a photo of the other guy's car right at the light there by City Hall. And the other guy was saying, what the heck are you doing?
Right. Except I bet
who gets out of the car and takes a photo with their cell phone of another guy's car?
I bet he didn't say heck, though, did he? Did he really say heck?
I don't know what that was all about. And then around noontime, I had two people banging on my door, and I said, well, who the heck could this be?
Did you say
heck? And I opened the door, and it was two guys working for the sheriff's department looking for somebody. It's like, oh. They said, don't worry, you're not in trouble. I said, oh, that's a good thing. But they had me looking at somebody's photo, and they say, you know Mr. So-and-so, and do you know who your office, where your office is located? We're looking for somebody. I said, oh, great. As long as they weren't looking for me, I guess. That was a good thing.
Right. Well, I think someone from
three crazy, wacky things happened to me on this crazy, wacky Thursday, I'm calling it.
Yes, it's a wacky Thursday, EZG.
Yeah, road rage, you know, that'd be an example that anybody listening to the this program. If somebody cuts you off, don't get out of the car, because that guy could have a knife, you know, he could have a gun.
What you should do is just...
with his fist.
Just wish them a Merry Christmas.
Just consider the guy, you know, had a bad day or something. The worst thing to do is don't get out of the car. I saw that earlier at the Snow Arena, going to Market Basket, where a guy got out of the car. The guy had a broken window. He had a little like plastic in there. He smacked his fist through it.
Oh my!
I told you the story before. And then the other guy went in the car, and then he got a hammer.
Jeez.
And he destroyed one of the guy's part of his car there. The what do you call that? The
mirrors.
Well, he destroyed part of the car with his hammer, and then next thing you know, when I came back from the basket with my groceries, they were at the MTA bus stop, and the police were there.
Yes.
It was crazy. Road rage.
Right. Maybe they were trying to have a hardcore wrestling match.
The guy was lucky, the guy to take the hammer to the guy that drove in the car. He took the hammer to the guy's car and broke part of his car. I said, what the hell is going on here? It was crazy. People need to calm down.
I agree, EZG.
So on that note, I'm going to clear the lines and have a good rest of your day.
All right, EZG, thank you. And happy holidays to you. A little Andy Williams there. I hope our friend Tony's not offended. Do you think we've offended Tony with the Happy Holidays song by Andy Williams?
Hopefully not.
It'd be pretty weird to be offended by Andy Williams, would it not? Do you even know who Andy Williams is? You're only 25 years old. A wee lad, a young urchin.
I recognize the song. That's all
yes.
I need to know.
Yes, the song has been, that's a song that has been done by many different folks over the years. Many secular anti-Christian people have done that song. Happy Holidays. Although, actually, well, maybe that's not the best example, because he does use the word Christmas in there as well. He works in some Christmas, I think, to hedge his bets, because he doesn't want to end up in hell for saying Happy Holidays. Let's see. In the Facebook live chat, hello to Stefan Philbrook, who is a top fan. Stefan says, impeachment, impeachment, impeachment. Yes. Wayne Noel joins us all the way from Michigan. Thomas Massengale joins us all the way from across the pond. Wayne says, here we go again. Impeachment, impeachment, impeachment. Stefan says, I totally see the impeachment path to go exactly the way one of your listeners that called in last week. I believe he said that it would pick up speed once articles of impeachment were drawn up and that it would go to secret ballot. I don't remember the caller's name. But his path totally makes sense. Yeah, you know what? I forget. That is a good point, Stefan. That's a great point. And I forget now who it was who said that. And I'm not sure exactly what would have to happen for it to go to a secret ballot. But that is the one thing. Actually, if that were to be done somehow, and I don't know how that works. I don't know the mechanics of how you get to being able to vote via a secret ballot. But if it were a secret ballot, then you might actually see a conviction of Trump in the Senate. Because my theory is that these Republicans in both the House and Senate probably really would love to throw Trump overboard and have Mike Pence as president. because Trump has made their lives kind of miserable. Right. So I think they would love to do that. But I don't know. I don't know exactly how that works with the secret ballot. And I don't know what, I haven't heard anyone talking about it other than the caller you're mentioning, Stefan. So I don't know if there's any chance of that happening. But assuming that there is no secret ballot, it'll just be, yeah, Trump will be acquitted in the Senate. And he'll probably have a similar effect as to what Bill Clinton experienced, where Bill Clinton actually had elevated poll numbers because his base, when Bill Clinton was impeached, his base felt that the impeachment was unfair. And so they kind of so he saw an uptick in support because he had a lot of sympathy for the impeachment. And you'll see the same thing, I believe, with Trump. You know, the MAGA people will be more energized and enthusiastic than ever before because the Democrats tried to take down their exalted hero. And I believe that will factor into Trump winning a second term. Hello to Chris H. Space in the Facebook live chat. Wayne says, I should plug Chris's band, Edgewise. Great band. Jenny and I went to see them recently. They opened for LA Guns at Club Jewel here in Manchester. Let's see. So Wayne says, these same pro-impeachment fanatics are also going to be the same that are shocked and cry when they realize the consequences when impeachment fails in the Senate. Well, I disagree with you in one sense, Wayne. I don't think they're going to... Oh, yeah. Okay, it depends on who you mean. But you know what? I mistook your statement a little bit because when you said these same pro-impeachment fanatics, I took that to mean the current members in the House who are voting to or who will be voting in favor of articles of impeachment. They know how this is going to turn out. That's why Nancy Pelosi, I believe, why she was so resistant to this initially, because it's obvious how this is going to turn out. You know, they'll vote to impeach. It will go to the Senate. The Senate will acquit him. But yeah, I do think that, Democrats who, voters who are thinking that this is going to somehow, and I think a lot of them are probably savvy too. I think broadly speaking, most people realize where this is all headed, but I'm sure there are some people who really think, oh yeah, this is going to get Trump when the reality is it's just not. Stefan says, oh, I really doubt this. But, I mean, it would be tantalizing to see this play out. Stefan said he will resign. Pence will pardon his federal crimes. Then he will need to face the music for his non-federal crimes. He will cry and beg for leniency. I don't think Trump will resign, no matter what. I just don't think so. And there's no guarantee that Pence would pardon him for anything. And even so, I think Trump wants to win a second term because it also, for now, kind of inoculates him in terms of the investigations going on in the state of New York, which he cannot be pardoned for. And I didn't even know this until the Trump presidency. I misunderstood how presidential pardons work in the sense that I thought, and the power of a presidential pardon is sweeping, but it was less sweeping than I realized. I thought the president could pardon anybody for anything, really, but it turns out that's not true. So, because for a long time people were speculating, oh, is Trump going to pardon himself? Which, constitutional scholars and attorneys' opinions vary on whether a president can actually pardon himself, but regardless, the president can only pardon himself, in theory, or others for federal crimes, not state crimes. So all the trouble that Trump is in, which people forget about, right? Because we're so focused on impeachment, we're so focused on Ukraine, we're so focused on this and that federally, on the Mueller report, which I think they should have, that's what he should have been impeached on. There's 12. I've read the Mueller report. Took a while. There's 12 instances of obstruction of justice, in my opinion, in the Mueller report. That's impeachable right there, in my view. But what's going on in the state of New York and the state AG's investigation of Trump is what will ultimately be his undoing. And, you know, he may be inoculated from any kind of prosecution as long as he's president. But once he's out, he cannot be pardoned for that, for whatever. And they already shut down the Trump Foundation. The state AG's office shut down the Trump Foundation in New York because they were self-dealing. And they actually told a judge ordered that the Trump family can never again operate a quote unquote charity in the state of New York because, you know, if you're going to open a charity, you can't use it as a criminal enterprise. You're supposed to actually use it as a charity. The law is pretty clear on that, apparently. So the Trump family can no longer operate a charity in the state of New York because they got caught, you know, doing dirty with it previously. So it's not supposed to be for your own enrichment. It's supposed to be, you know, it's a charity. It's supposed to help other people. So that gets a little sticky. Jenny says Reagan would be sick to his stomach, as we talked about when she called. Stefan says, how long can we pay farmers $18 billion to not farm? Yeah, like that should be maddening to everybody. Of course, MAGA people don't mind, but you have a trade policy. You have Trump's trade policy, which has destroyed so many American farms. But to try not to make them too mad, they're getting government subsidies to try to make up for some of their losses. So in case you didn't know, our tax dollars are being used to subsidize these farmers as they're taking these enormous losses because of Trump's trade policy. And, you know, I know Republicans probably don't mind that because, number one, it's Trump. And number two, the very concept of fiscal conservatism is all but dead. I mean, it's fiscal conservatism is it doesn't really exist. I mean, actually, Greg Moore from Americans for Prosperity, he was on the show once. This was a while ago. And he actually said that Bill Clinton was the last fiscally conservative president, a Democrat. Because Bill Clinton actually ran a surplus. Reagan was no fiscal conservative. Again, we go back to St. Ronald Reagan. He ran up huge deficits during his presidency. George W. Bush ran up huge deficits. We had two wars going on. They didn't even put them on the books. They were not included in the budget. They were just sort of magically somewhere else. And of course, that costs tremendous amounts of money. And, you know, and then that continued with Obama. And now with Trump, we have the largest, we're running the largest deficits in American history under Trump. Yeah, but nobody cares about that anymore, you know. I mean, if you go back to W, Dick Cheney famously said, deficits don't matter. Essentially taking the same position as the Democrats, because Democrats always say deficits don't matter. You can just print more money. Well, apparently that's what Republicans think now, too. Every once in a while, I'll hear a Republican say, well, you know, I'm concerned about the deficit. Really? No, you're not. The only time Republicans are worried about the debt and the deficit is when a Democrat is president, because then you have something to use against him. As soon as a Democrat's not president, y'all just stop caring about the deficit and the debt. It's the most phony thing in the world. I just roll my eyes whenever I hear, well, unless it's someone sincere, of course, like Dr. Jeff Cassell, he genuinely does care about the deficit and the debt, but he also acknowledges that his fellow Republicans have been completely phony on the issue. Ed Murphy joins us in the Facebook live chat. Ed says, I wish people a happy birthday, Jesus Day. Well, I think that's even nicer than saying Merry Christmas, and certainly far more accommodating to our Christian friends than Happy Holidays. I still can't believe EZG said that. Oh, Ryan Gorman joins us in the Facebook live chat. Ryan, hello. It would be wonderful to have you back on the show sometime. It's been too long. Tony Petrello is also in the Facebook live chat. Tom Blanchard joins us in the Facebook live chat. Tom says, wouldn't it be funny if he resigned and then turned around and then run for president again and then he won again? I don't know if it would be funny. That'd be pretty weird. That's like an acid trip of a theory. But I do wonder, though, I guess technically he could do that.
Yeah.
Right? Because he wouldn't have...
Because if he resigned before this upcoming or the election process, but if he did it before... Because think about it. If we resigned before any of the primaries or even the general election, if he resigned from the presidency, gave up 4 years and then came back, would that make sense?
Yeah, in theory, I guess he could even just resign whenever he wanted and then Pence would be president and then he could just run. He could run. He'd still win all the primaries and he'd still be the nominee. He could resign and then be the nominee again for this election.
Yeah.
In theory. I mean, I don't know what the point would be, but it'd be pretty weird. But you know, we were talking earlier about the multiverse theory.
Yeah.
There could be a universe where that's actually happening right now, where yeah. Trump is on live television tendering his resignation and then runs and wins again.
Yeah.
That could be happening, Michael
yep.
Martineau.
Yep.
We don't know. We don't know. Let's see. Ooh, it's already almost the top of the hour. This is...
Flying by today.
Flying by. Flying by. Let's see. Do we have a new... Oh, yes. I wanted to address this, too. This came to us on the text line. Someone says, hey, Matt, that was a great intro. Oh, I'm sorry. This is part of the message I left earlier, but I never answered this person's question. So at the beginning of the text, they wanted to know who the song was that I played during the intro. Or maybe they do know and they're just commenting that they like the song. But that was Randy Rainbow, for anyone who doesn't know who's interested. The song I played at the top of the show, If You Ever Got Impeached... that was the great Randy Rainbow, who I think is very, very funny. And, of course, you can find Randy Rainbow on YouTube. We'll take a break in a couple minutes. But first, because this kind of relates to what we've been talking about, this is from my favorite website and hopefully yours, rightwingwatch.org. According to Johnny Enlow, who is a pastor and a leading proponent of Seven Mountains Dominionism, which apparently is a show and an organization. Pastor Enslow claims that God is using Trump to separate history into before Trump and after Trump eras. So that would be very exciting. So we could actually, I guess... what he's suggesting is God is using Trump to, I guess we'll be starting over at year one, and it'll be year one AT after Trump. That's an exciting development, right?
Yeah. It seems interesting.
We should do that now. So instead of, because the thing is, next year is 2020, and there's going to be all these jokes about it. Like, people are going to be saying, oh, wow, I see things really clearly this year, you know, because it's 2020. Or people are going to be saying, oh, hey, Happy New Year. We're in touch, so you be in touch. You youngins don't even know that reference. But they used to say that at the end of a program called 2020 on ABC on Friday nights. Barbara Walters would say that. And Hugh Downs. Remember Hugh Downs? He's been dead a long time. Oh, where does the time go? Where does the time go, Michael Martineau? You don't even know who I'm talking about, do you? A wee lad, a young urchin as yourself.
I know who Bob Walters is.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yes. Yes, she used to, that was the tagline at the end of 2020 every week. We're in touch, so you be in touch. So there's going to be all these jokes about 2020. So let's just avoid 2020. Instead of having 2020 on January 1st, let's just have it be year one year one AT after Trump. It's perfect. But maybe the idea is that that won't be happening until after he's left office. I don't know. But let's listen to Pastor Enloe. And by the way, I know that I just want to mention this. For those of you who might be new to the show, because I know some of you are probably rolling your eyes at this and you're probably thinking, who is this Pastor Enloe and why is he so ridiculous? And this is a silly theory. And I agree, you're probably right. But for those of you who are new, we do have kind of an unofficial policy on the show. In an instant like this, I'm going to play the audio for you. I believe that it would, especially in the spirit of the holidays, including Christmas, in case Tony's listening, I believe that we should listen to this and listen to Pastor Enloe, not only with open minds, but with open hearts, shall we? So let's listen to him explain the new system of before Trump and after Trump. This is very exciting if this is true.
I was asking the Lord about it. He hadn't told me. And I was like, Lord, you still haven't showed me. And then on March, right when I'm saying that, I have this, oh, it's not an open vision, but it was a vision. Oh. And in the vision, I see this circular mountain that goes up, and there's a path all the way up. And at the top is Donald Trump, and he's on a motorcycle. And he's on a motorcycle, and he's making a lot of noise with it. And he has red, white, and blue bandana on his head. And so in an instant, it wasn't hard for me to figure out what was being said. It's the only time I've ever, while seeing a vision, actually talked out loud. And I go, oh, no, because I was like, this means this is not going to be a peaceful exchange. This is not a peaceful transition we're going into. This is something more. And then I was brought in real close to the motorcycle, and it was triumph, which was further confirmation. And so I was like, Lord, as I'm saying that, the first thing he said is, he is going to save you from things you don't know you need to be saved from yet. And then the Lord progressively began to speak regarding that. And he said, this time in the presidency is going to be a hinge of the ages. And you be known as before Trump and after Trump because of the way I'm going to use him. I'm using him as a Trump card, but I'm the Trump card player. And so your nation will be known as before Trump and after Trump. And he said, the nations, the will be known as before Trump, after Trump. And the Lord, it was like, he's like, I'm really not interested in your all's vote this time. I'm doing it. I usually give you all that option. This time I'm not. This is a rescue operation from heaven. This is this is a moment of the ages. This will go down. This time period will go down as a before and after AD, you know, but BC, AD, depending on what terminology you use.
AC/DC, whatever, yeah. Yeah, so there you go. That's Pastor Enloe. Now, and he's probably right because, after all, he did receive a vision. And who are we to question that if you receive a vision? Michael Martineau, have you ever received a vision from the Lord?
I have not.
Right. But if you do, don't be surprised if it's explaining to you how time will be different in the future. And don't be surprised if the vision includes Trump on a motorcycle with a red, white, and blue bandana. Wouldn't that be exciting?
Yes, it would be.
That would be quite a vision. So let's see. Tom Blanchard. Tony Petrello said this. I apologize. I got the wrong T name here. Tony said, don't forget 2020 will be hindsight. Oh, my goodness. Well, that does deserve an air horn, sir. There we go. So I think we'll play. We'll take a break. It is the top of the hour. We'll be back with more Unleashed in a few minutes. But let's. Well, we got a little teaser of this. This is for you, Tony. If you're not Tony Petrello, but the Tony who called yesterday. A little Andy Williams, unencumbered by the voice of EZG in the background. Here it is. This is Happy Holiday.
Happy holiday.
Happy holiday.
Happy holiday.
Happy holiday.
While the merry bells keep ringing, happy holiday to you.
Happy holiday. Happy holiday.
It's the holiday season, And Santa Claus is coming round. The Christmas snow is white on the ground. When old Santa gets into town, he'll be coming down the chimney down.
He'll be coming down the chimney down.
It's the holiday season, and Santa Claus has got a toy for every good girl and good little boy. Santa's a great big bundle of joy when he's coming down the chimney down.
When he's coming down the chimney down,
he'll have a big fat pack upon his back, and lots of goodies for you and for me. So leave a peppermint stick for old Saint Nick hanging on the Christmas tree. It's the holiday season,
the holiday season.
So hoop-dee-doo and dickery-dock, don't forget to hang up your sock, 'cause just exactly at 12 o'clock he'll be coming down the chimney down.
He'll be coming down the chimney down.
He'll have a big fat pack upon his back,
yeah!
And lots of goodies for you and for me. So leave a peppermint stick for old Saint Nick hanging on a Christmas tree. It's the holiday season,
the holiday season.
So hoop-dee-doo and dickery-dock, don't forget to hang up your sock, 'cause just exactly at 12 o'clock he'll be coming down the chimney, coming down the chimney, coming down the chimney down.
Happy holiday.
Happy holiday.